welcome once again to San Angelo Bible, Angelo Bible Church, but it's in the city of San Angelo, right? So, so welcome. This Christmas season is rapidly approaching, so today we're going to once again sing some Christmas songs. But I do want to point out we have Jenny Waller and her mom back here. Now, this is Isai mentioned her, was it last week? He mentioned that she's coming. She's a missionary with GoTen. And to Malaysia. So she's here, and we have an opportunity to visit with her. So after the service, my wife's visiting with her right now. Right? No, that's all right. So I would be doing it too if I could. But after the service, if you get a chance to come visit with Jenny
and her mom,
and see what's going on in Malaysia and in the Waller clan. And the rest, some more of the Waller clan should be showing up here. Are they coming this morning, Tommy? They're coming this morning? Okay.
All right.
So, let's get some announcements out of the way. Before we start singing, we're going to sing a bunch of Christmas songs. And so let's get some announcements out of the way. And the offering, we'll do that. So what do we got going on this week? I think it's caroling tonight. So we're going to meet here at 5 o'clock.
Which is early. 5 o'clock.
It's not even sundown
because
yet.
The folks we're caroling to will start eating at 5:30.
There we go.
We're trying to get there for their dinner time. I don't know. Some of the older folks seem to eat early. I don't know. Do you? Me.
Yeah, me. Yeah, I like eating late has become a difficulty as I get a little older. So. 5 o'clock, we'll meet here, and then we'll go out and do a little caroling at 5:30. The ladies' video Bible study is on Tuesday. Don't forget that, ladies, 6:30 p.m. That's this week, Tuesday. And we are having a Christmas Eve service Sunday the 24th at 6 p.m. And we're getting all the plans together for all that. It's going to be awesome, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. It's going to be awesome.
So 6 o'clock, the 24th. So let's fill the place up and have a wonderful Christmas Eve service. I used to think I loved it when Christmas is on a Sunday, but it's really kind of neat when Christmas is on a Monday, too, because mm-hmm. we get to do this mm-hmm. on a Sunday night. So Christmas Eve service next Sunday. And let me see, the fifth Sunday fellowship. So the last Sunday of this month, that's, as you can clearly see, the 31st, we're going to have a fellowship. So bring some food. That'll be Sunday night, New Year's Eve.
Yeah.
Yes. And it looks like there will be a business meeting January 6th.
Yes.
January 6th. Is that exciting
I'm
to you?
I'm excited. We're going to have a church business meeting. Good. I was hoping we'd have one of those.
I'm awake.
Most people kind of rue the business meetings, but that's clearly some sarcasm there.
No, I'm excited.
But
there are many things
our guys,
to talk about
our
it.
Guys that are,
if you love ABC, you need to be there.
They're taking care of stuff, and the Lord has blessed this body. So it should be a very
Amen.
Positive and good meeting on the 6th of January following the morning service. So don't forget that. I don't want anybody to be surprised when we're going to do that after the morning service. So, and if you did not avail yourselves of the church directories that have been printed and published out in the foyer, go ahead and grab a copy of that. They're out there, the 2024 directory. And now, if I have the ushers that will come forward, I'll pray, and we will receive the offering. Father, it is a privilege to give back just a little bit of what you've blessed us with, Lord. We do so willingly as an act of worship. We bless you with it. We pray, Lord, that you would hold us accountable for its use. We pray, Lord, that your name would be glorified in everything we do with these funds as we strive to use them to spread the gospel and to help transform lives in this area and the people we come in contact with and through our missionaries, Lord. And may we help expand your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Joy to the world. Thank you.
sit and sing, but it's Christmas songs. So join us as much as you're able.
Jesus.
Isaiah 61, verses 1 through 3 says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Matthew 1, verses 18 through 25, we read, Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So all this was done, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God with us. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife, and did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Now would be a good time to sit down. We don't want you to have to stand through the whole service.
Christmas.
This song is such a good reminder of Christmas because, you know, Jesus was sitting down for us as a baby. He took off his godliness and he put on his humanness so he could relate to us. And that all of that stems from just a love of the world that God has. It's just so powerful and so amazing. And we just wanted to sing about that today.
His one and only Son to save. For God so loved the world that He gave us His one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in Him will live forever. The power of hell forever defeated. Now it is well. I'm walking in so loved, God so loved the world. Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
We haven't been here long enough to have what an intermission, but they call it an interlude. The last couple of weeks I've been praying about what approach we would use in our Christmas program. This is our Christmas program, by the way, this morning, and that's why we have the extra music, and what would God give us as a theme? And out of nowhere, just into my head came this phrase, beauty for ashes. And I thought, wait a minute, beauty for ashes is not in any of the Christmas stories. It's not Matthew, it's not Luke. It's not even in Galatians 4, where we've been studying about God sending forth his son into the world. And so what does that have to do with Christmas? So it set me on a kind of a journey, because I believed it was God giving me that information, that thought, beauty for ashes. And I know that in my own life, that phrase means a lot. I mean, every one of us has a beauty for ashes story, at least one, if not a lot of them, where things that we had held on to, things that we had hoped for, situations, circumstances, whatever it was, burned into ash, and yet God used that to give amazing beauty. So I went on a journey with this, and I'm going to share that with you. During his ministry, Jesus returned to Nazareth, his hometown. You know that story. And he went into the synagogue, and he read from the book of Isaiah, the 61st chapter. And here is what his account of reading this in Luke. I'm going to have to turn this way. I can read on my notes. Luke 4:18-22. It says, Jesus is reading from the prophet. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And then Jesus did the most amazing thing. He looked around the room and he said, "This day, these scriptures are true in me. They are applied. They are fulfilled in your hearing." The only response that the people would give Jesus, although they were amazed, maybe they were amazed that he would even say that this messianic, beautifully, powerfully expressed messianic scripture would be portrayed in him, their only response was one of ridicule. They said, "Is not this Joseph's son? Joseph's son?" Yes. Joseph was his earthly dad, his adoptive son, but of course Joseph was so much more, and Jesus was so much more. Were they willing to listen? Joseph could have told them his own story about the one who was given to save the world. And if you do a little research into Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 and 2 is what Jesus quoted from, but the entire section, verses 1 through 3, applies to Messiah. It applies to Jesus. And the third verse says this: "To console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." See, Jesus came to fulfill the whole passage. He quoted from 1 and 2, but he came to fulfill all of these fours: the beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, trading our weakness for his strength, trading our sorrow for his joy, trading everything about us that's broken for his wholeness. Our main point today is beauty for ashes is offered to everyone who receives the gift of God's Son. If you received the gift of God's Son, he's already working that miracle in you. He's taken the ashes of your life and he's exchanging them. He's giving you beauty. How many of you have seen it? Right? Amen. That's what we hope for. You know that Jesus didn't come to save the prideful and the wealthy and all the people that have everything. He came to save those that are broken. And even if we have everything, we're still broken. We're going to look at the story of Joseph from that perspective today. And I have an assistant. for our season this is Joseph for now. He's not dressed particularly like Joseph, a modern Joseph, but a young man, because I was going to do this monologue myself, and I thought, it's kind of stretching credulity for you to think that I'm an 18 to 20-year-old groom about to be. So Samuel and I are going to have a little interchange here as we do this. But to start the story, we're going to look at a deepening of ashes, where everything just goes from bad to worse to horrible, and the ashes just get deeper and deeper. I want to give you a backdrop to this. Israel, as you know, at that time, had not been free for about 500 years. 500 years since the captivity. 500 years or more since they came back from captivity, and then 400 silent years where they lived in the land under foreign rule. First the Medes, then the Greeks, and finally the Romans. And it was a pretty iron-fisted rule that was imposed upon them. Governmentally, they were oppressed and in ashes. Spiritually, they were bankrupt as well, because the true worship of God had turned into a system that was run by greed and power and religion, not true faith and worship of the living God. There were people who certainly did, and Joseph was one, but the system itself was broken at the time. It was a time of great poverty. It's said that 80% of the people that lived in the broader Roman world, including in Palestine at the time, lived at poverty level or below. People were poor. People were scraping to get by. And that the land, which could provide a living for most of the people in, for example, Galilee, had been taken from the people, and they were living, most of them, in villages, small villages like Nazareth and Bethlehem, some small villages where maybe there might be 500 people, but they subsisted together and found ways to survive. And then there was the taxation. Taxation at the day, in that day, when you add up the religious taxes, the temple tax, the Levites' taxes, and then the, of course, the animal sacrifices that had to be given, and then the Roman tax, the tax could easily amount to 50%. Of a poor person's income. It was a very, very difficult time to make a living and be alive financially and even politically and spiritually at that time. But Joseph was a young man. We believe he was from 18 to 20, and he had a reason to hope because he had a skill that he learned from his dad. We know from the scripture that he's the son of a carpenter, and that Jesus was the son of a carpenter, and that Jesus himself was a carpenter. The text literally could be translated builder, and the idea there is that these were skilled people. They could make things with their hands. They could make furniture. They could make utensils. They could make wagons or carts. They could make boats. They could make because although the houses were generally made of mud brick in that time, they could make the framework, the truss work, for the roof systems in the homes. They had very useful skills, and because Joseph had this ability, he could consider that his future was in his own hands. Literally, he had that skill and ability to make something of his life. So he had reason to hope, in spite of the ashes of the culture around him, that he might be able to produce a life for himself, his young bride-to-be. And he was engaged to a woman as tradition would show us, even younger than he was, probably in her mid-teens, if Joseph was 18 to 20. He was engaged to be married to a younger teenage girl named Mary, and he had hopes of love, a home, a family, and plans for happiness. Surely, Joseph could overcome the obstacles of his place and time. But the story begins with crushing news. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother, Mary, was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Spirit. Now, when we read this story, we know, we're even told, that Matthew gives us a heads up, doesn't he? Jesus is going to give birth, Mary's going to give birth to Jesus, and she was betrothed to Joseph, but the child is born of the Holy Spirit. He was enlivened and developed in her womb by the power of the Holy Spirit. We know this, but Joseph didn't know this. All Joseph knew is that his betrothed was pregnant. She was, quote unquote, found with child, which very likely means the community knew about it, or people, you know, in a small town like this, word gets out. Others knew as well. So let's put ourselves in Joseph's shoes.
I can't believe it. I can't believe it, but it must be true. She said it herself. She said, "Yes, I am pregnant." I didn't know what to say. I just turned and ran. My Mary pregnant, unfaithful, with another man? Who? Why? How? This cannot be happening. All our plans, all our dreams, our hopes, shattered. What am I going to do?
Joseph struggled. His life seemed finished before it had even begun. Scripture goes on to tell us, then Joseph, her husband, remember, he's betrothed, but it was a legal binding contract at that time. He was thought to be her husband. Being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought on these things, you can put yourself in Joseph's shoes, and you know that's all he could think about. That's all he could think about. And then as night came on, Joseph is tossing and turning and unable to sleep.
I thought we were following God's plan. How can this be? I can't marry her. I can't take her to court. I love Mary too much to expose her to the shame of an open divorce. I'll do my best to keep this under wraps, but that baby is not mine. I don't know what to do, but I have to figure something out.
Finding himself sinking deeper and deeper into the ashes of despair, Joseph finally falls into a fitful slumber. And while he's sleeping, Joseph receives a heavenly visitor. Matthew 1:20b says, "Behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit.'" And here we find that beauty is beginning to show up. God gives beauty of hope for the ashes of fear.
What kind of dream is this? What am I seeing? Is this an angel of God speaking directly to me? He knows my name. He knows I am descended from David. Okay, I'm paying attention. Afraid? You know I'm afraid. How can I not be when my entire world is falling apart? What are you saying? Mary wasn't unfaithful, but she is expecting. She hasn't been with another man? This is the work of the Holy Spirit? What? How? Why? Is this really God's doing? Could there be hope in all of this?
And of course, there is hope. God gives the beauty also of purpose to Joseph in the midst of everything falling apart, for the ashes of sin's destructive power. We next read, "And she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins."
Okay, you're telling me my wife to be has conceived by the Holy Spirit and will deliver a baby boy? Whose son is he? Is he God's son? But he will be part of my family, my son too. And you want me to name him Jesus? I get to name him? And he will save his people from their sins. Who is this baby? Could he be the promised one, the Messiah of God?
God gives his presence with us for 400 years of silence due to sin. We continue to read, "So all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, 'Behold, the virgin will be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which is translated God with us.
Later, after I thought about it, I understood. This baby would fulfill the promise of God in Isaiah that a virgin, my bride-to-be, would conceive and bear a son, and finally, after 400 years of silence, we would not only hear from God, but he would join us, become one of us so he could save us. He would be the seed of the woman promised long ago in the garden to undo the curse of sin and bring us to God. I am humbled and overjoyed to have a part in his plan.
Knowing all of this, hearing from the angel, having the plan laid out before him, the oven by itself is not enough. When God reveals beauty for ashes, it yet remains for us to take action. We have such a good example of Joseph in this. In verse 24, we're told, then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took to him his wife, and did not know her until she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus.
Okay, I'm awake now. I've never had a dream like that. God sent his angel to reveal his plan to me. He has replaced pain and sorrow and suffering of sin with his life-giving grace. He turned the worst day of my life into the best, and I will take him at his word. I will take Mary to be my wife. I know people will talk, but this is God's doing, not mine. I will do my part. She will remain a virgin until this child is born. I will love this boy as my own, and I will call his name Jesus. Thank you, God, for including me in your plan to save the world.
What an amazing example of God turning ashes into beauty, giving beauty for ashes. And it's just the beginning. Christmas is the story of God giving beauty for ashes at every turn. It's the same with the story of Mary. It's the same with the story of the shepherds. The angel said, don't be afraid, for behold, I give you good tidings of great joy. Beauty for ashes, the wise men. Beauty for ashes, because they were coming to worship the king, but of course Herod had other plans. But God brought beauty out of ashes. Christmas is the story of God giving light for darkness, peace for conflict, joy for sorrow, faith for fear, and life for death. And every one of us that knows Jesus has a beauty for ashes story in our lives and can yet expect more to come. He may have given you the beauty of faith for the ashes of fear. He may have given you the beauty of hope for the ashes of despair. The beauty of joy for the ashes of sorrow. The beauty of peace for the ashes of turmoil. The beauty of love for the ashes of a broken heart. And ultimately, he offers the beauty of life for the ashes of death. And all of this is caught up in the song that Sam and Courtney sang about, and we know it is John 3:16. Let's read it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. He gives us the beauty of everlasting life for the ashes of perishing. Of what we deserve, of where our sin takes us. And he does it every single time. The praise team will come up. We'll finish our final song. And I had no idea we'd get through this early. I hope y'all, you know, don't think this is the beginning of a new thing.
Come,
God, that's our worship, that's our praise today in this Christmas, God, that we worship you because you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to be born on earth as a man, to live a perfect life and to die for us. God, we recognize that this act, this progression, this event gave us our relationship with you, God, gave us the ability to connect with you, gave us salvation, God. We see that. We see that. We pray, God, that this holiday season you would impress that on our hearts, that that would be what defines us this Christmas. That would be what defines us this year. That would be what defines us for our whole lives. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And since we're getting out a little early today, be sure to visit with Jenny and Pansy and the rest.